according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
He had momentary doubts, definitely something that I can identify with. In this day and age, we are encouraged to be skeptical of things that look too good to be true, of things that are too fantastical to believe, of things that are simply jokes at our expense, either in fun or with intent. In this age of technological wonders and those who are adept at managing them, geniuses at computer manipulation have awed us with special effects. There are those who have used their talents to hack and spam us into revealing information we would prefer not to. We are constantly warned not to believe everything we see and hear. But even years before all this technology, there have always been those who would deceive us for personal gain, for illegal activities, or more benignly, just for a good laugh. So why does history condemn poor Thomas for his doubt in something for which he had no proof? Who was Thomas? Much of what we know of Thomas is found in the book of John. Besides the four other places in the Bible where the disciples are listed by name, Thomas is mentioned only four times. We know his name means the twin, though we don't know whose twin. And he was born in Galilee to a humble family. He went fishing with Simon, James, John, and the others when Jesus appeared to them on the beach. And he's recorded speaking with Jesus at Lazarus' funeral, with the other disciples before Christ's death, and when Jesus appeared to him after he doubted the disciples' word. That's it. And yet we all know him because he was labeled Doubting Thomas. It's made him famous or infamous. But Thomas was also known to be an admirable person. I don't think Jesus would have chosen him as a disciple otherwise. From his first conversation with Jesus in John 11 at Lazarus' funeral, we see that Thomas was courageous and loyal. When Jesus said that he was returning to Judea despite the danger, Thomas rallied the other disciples, saying, "Let's go that we can die with him." Remember, all the disciples had already given up their previous lives to follow Jesus, and now Thomas was ready to die for this man. Thomas was also willing to be taught. From John 14, after Jesus tells the 12 how he will go to prepare a place in heaven for them and that they know the way, Thomas says, "We don't know where you're going. How can we know the way?" Thomas had the courage to ask Jesus to clarify what he meant. One scholar has said of Thomas that it's better to be ignorant for a few minutes and ask a question rather than not ask at all and remain ignorant. Jesus understood Thomas's question and answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Many times the disciples fell back on their belief that Jesus, as the Messiah, would reign here on earth during their lifetime. He was the one that would free the Jewish nation from Rome and restore it to its former glory, as had been taught to them by the priests in the synagogues. Jesus could not die. The prophets had promised that the Messiah would make everything right. Now that he was here, all would be well. Jesus would tell them what was going to happen, what had to happen, and that he was going to the Father. But they did not understand. This could not be right. The Son of God can't die. And when they witnessed his death on the cross, it shattered their confidence in their belief. They were afraid. But then Jesus appeared to them, restoring their faith, filling them with joy. But Thomas did not see this confirmation. We don't know where he was. When the disciples told Thomas what had happened, it must have seemed just too good to be true, too fantastical to believe. He needed proof. He needed to see this miracle for himself. And this is something we can identify with, something we can easily understand. If we want to learn, we must be humble and not be afraid to admit we don't know. We must believe in Jesus, but know that he understands that this is sometimes difficult. He responds to our honest questions. Thomas wasn't there when Christ first appeared to the first disciples. The rest of the disciples. He wanted proof. He didn't want to simply hear their report. And Jesus understood and responded, appearing again so that Thomas's doubt would disappear. Jesus knew that Thomas was battling with doubt. He invited Thomas to touch his wounds and see for himself. Jesus understands our battles with doubt and invites us to come near and believe. Today, millions of people stubbornly want to witness miracles, want to see Jesus for themselves before they will believe in him. But God asks us to come to him in faith. To wait and see may be too late. Thomas didn't ask for a special revelation from Jesus. He merely asked for the same proof the other disciples had. He wanted, maybe needed, to know for himself. And Jesus didn't rebuke him. He didn't humiliate him. He could see deep into Thomas's heart and understood his honest desire to know the truth. But Jesus also knew that from then on, the faith in the unseen would prevail. For Christians, it is not to see is to believe, but rather to believe is to see. That is faith. In Hebrews 11, it said, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Faith is the evidence, the proof. Jesus did not condemn Thomas's pessimism or lack of faith. He came down to his level, overcoming Thomas's fear and uncertainty with compassion and grace. How much more is Christ willing to do for those who struggle with faith today? Jesus reminded Thomas and his fellow disciples that because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. Jesus knew that the new church would have to take the disciples' word on faith, and that it was important that these leaders of that new church had no doubts. Jesus was providing the backbone of what would be the start of the wondrous spread of God's word around the world. As Christians today, it is true that to doubt is easier than to have faith. However, as long as we stay close to God, remember his promises, and follow his will in our lives, there's no reason to live in doubt. But questions are always allowed, even encouraged. It shows an engaged mind and an open spirit with a willingness to be taught. Thomas grew in his faith. After witnessing the proof of Jesus' resurrection and receiving the Holy Spirit, Thomas became as zealous as the other disciples, becoming an instrumental leader in the church, helping to spread the gospel. And we know this from the writings of other historical documents of that time. Thomas didn't let his momentary doubt stop him from following Christ. All the disciples continued to prepare themselves for the work Jesus would give them with the Great Commission: to go forth and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of God and teaching them what he commanded. We continue his work. A moment of weakness should not define us. All the disciples deserted Jesus during the trial. They were all afraid and went into hiding after the crucifixion. Thomas is singled out because he wasn't there to see Jesus' first appearance to his disciples and expressed his doubt. But if any of them had not been there like Thomas, do we honestly think that they would not have had doubts too? They had seen, so they had their proof. And Jesus understood Thomas's doubt and gave him the proof he desired. Through God's mercy and goodness, we are not consumed when we commit mistakes and sin. We can always turn back to God, ask him for forgiveness, and change our ways. Thankfully, God does not take snapshots of our lives and base his judgment on those. Rather, he takes a motion picture and takes into consideration not just what we were, but of what we can become from start to finish. Thomas was just like most of us, skeptical and afraid at times. However, with God's help, Thomas became a great instrument in the hands of his Maker. We too can make a positive change in our lives and be like Thomas. He found his faith and proclaimed, "My Lord and my God."